Welcome back to Rush Hour. My name is Mubarak Mugabe. We get into the big issue of the day. Today is Easter Monday, and we want to talk about parenting in this 21st century. Sometimes you go and meet parents with their children. The conversation there sometimes can as well be not the one that we used to know in our societies. Children these days are now so much addicted to, gadgets, tech gadgets. And we want to know how actually we can have right parenting in this kind of a generation which has broken all the chains of some cultures, some religions, and of course some practices that we have had in our traditional societies. With me in studio is a parenting coach, Dickson Turiame, and I want to actually welcome him this morning. He's joining me to have a conversation about this whole subject. A very good morning, Dickson, and thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much, my brother. I'm glad to be here.
First of all, you were a parenting coach. How did you get into this business and what inspired you there?
First of all, my background, how I was raised. When I was growing up, I was very small, I was tiny. Mm. I used to stammer a lot. And there's someone who used to tell me that because I was tiny and short, mm-hmm. and used to be very small, mm. that I would not become anybody. I remember when I was in my P1, I had my distant relative, my uncle, who was short, but married, and that time there was graduated tax. So they would say that that man does not pay graduated tax because they think that he's a child. So they would say, you man, you're going to eat people's...
It was like a bully.
Yes,
some kind of bullying. Yes.
Real bullying every now and then. Not one person, not two people. So they say, this man will never be paying taxes because he would always say that I'm young.
Yes.
They not be paying graduated tax.
Graduated tax,
so that is paining. Mm. I said, I will study. Because I had already heard that people are working. They pay tax to government.
Yes.
I said, I will study also at least
paying tax.
Pay. So then I kept growing up with that passion of speaking on behalf of a child.
Yes.
Then later, I decided to work with children. So when I finished campus, I started working in primary schools back in my home district of Weru district. I was working with Skoa, Uganda, working in primary schools, studying about HIV/AIDS.
Mm.
Then after 1 year, I joined Compassion International as study projects. As a child advocate,
mm.
and that actually shaped my desire and passion for working with children. I even did a 1 year course in child protection.
Bullying actually shaped your future.
Yeah, bullying actually shaped my future. So for me, challenges have really shaped what I am today. Some people think that challenges are bad, but to me, they have made me what I am.
Who are these people who are trying to bully you?
Old people, villagers. You know, fellow villagers, and these are old people. Yeah, not just only peers, but old people even. Youth, like someone of
they didn't years. Know that
yeah,
actually they
people
are
people do things ignorantly, not knowing what impact they are causing on a child.
Mm.
So to me, it was something that
it made you angry.
Yeah, so angry.
So you said, I think I should be the last person.
Yeah.
To face this kind of bullying and all that.
Yeah.
Are you seeing? Because I mean, did you find that in the way these people were brought up, or it was just because of other social factors?
I think social factors around us. People take things for granted. Well, because also I was very young, I wouldn't pay keen attention of knowing that maybe it's what they are, their background, how they are being raised in their homes.
Mm.
Because these are your neighbors, these are your village mates that you see daily.
Yes.
So you don't take it serious, but you as a child, okay, you don't want to know what is happening in their homes.
Mm.
But you as a child, it largely affects you.
Yes. So like, after getting that, so you said, when I go to university, this is what I'm going to do.
What I'm going to do. And I would pray every day. I would tell God, for me, I want to work with children.
How would you define
working with youth?
Define for us parenting. What does it mean?
Parenting is a process of raising children, whether biological or not biological.
Mm.
But children that you're with. Then you support them and promote them. You promote their physical, you promote
support them, giving them money.
No, not money. You support them physically, socially, emotionally, spiritually, intellectually.
Mm.
No, making sure that you raise them, that you develop them and promote all their abilities from childhood to adulthood. So it's a process.
Yes.
It takes, because you know there's different stages of growth. From 0 to 5 years, from 5 years to 10 years, then from childhood, from this infancy stage, you come to the teens. From teens, you come to the adolescence and then the youth. And then until you become an adult, when you, according to our Ghanaian constitution, is 18 years and above. But you know, as, at a family level, even me and you still, we are children before our parents.
Absolutely. Yeah. Now we have had single parenting, co-parenting, and of course, the normal family parenting that we know, mm-hmm. mother and father. Mm. So, do they have the same principles or practices?
No. Okay, first of all, somehow we are, our parenting is determined by the styles, our parenting styles. So sometimes even when the principles are the same, but because of our nature, our background, our the way we are nurtured, we cannot do the same things at the same time. So we are influenced by our personalities, how we are raised up and groomed. So a lot of things. So I can't say yes, much as we have clear principles of parenting, but
The way somebody's raised up, for example, if do you have, you know, does it have any impact, for example, to be raised by a single parent or raised in a normal family where there is a father and a father, or a parented, maybe a person parented by the grandfathers or, you know, guardians? Is there a difference in how actually we develop children?
Yes, there's a big difference because, for example, a child who is raised by a single parent, especially children who are raised by only mothers, they lack a father figure in their homes. And that's always their desire, that I wish I had a father figure. I wish maybe, even actually right now we have parents. We have children who have both parents, but their fathers are not in the house.
Dixon, can you tell that this person was raised by a single parent? From their conduct, from their behavior?
I may not somehow tell from what they are doing, but sometimes when you look at the behaviors of someone, can say, but this child was not well groomed, was not well mentored. So may not necessarily know that maybe it was one parent doing it, whether female or male parent, but you can look and say, this child was not well groomed. There's something lacking in this child. You look at their behavior, look at how they conduct themselves in public, look at how they do things, how they speak, look at how they take life. They are not concerned. So you know, there's something missing in this child.
Is it the same, does it apply to the same single, the single parent of a father or a single father and a single mother? If, for example, they are both raising a child, would you see a difference in these children?
Of course, children who are raised by mothers, they are more compassionate. Uh-huh. They are more understanding. They are not so much violent because at least, you know, mothers somehow bring their children together and make sure that they're in charge and control because they're always with them. Uh-huh. Yet for fathers, we are always not so much into the children. You can be present, but you're not really close and affectionate to this child like the mother. So somehow there's a difference. And don't know, so for example, let me give an example. Like from when I'm not at home, my children, we have three children. They all come and sleep with their mother in their bed. As long as I'm not at home, for them it's a sure deal.
Yeah.
It now for me when I'm there, I don't do that. Now you see the difference.
Yes.
So now what do you think?
When you are home and your mother is not there, they don't come to sleep with you.
No, they didn't sleep with me, all of them.
You are rude.
No, I'm not rude. But
you're rude to them.
I'm not rude to them, but I told them, you know, you guys, okay, for them they don't even ask.
Yes, they know when dad is there, we are not going.
But I'm thought when I'm not there, they tell the mother we want to come and give you protection. They don't tell me. Now you can see the difference.
Yes.
So as they come sleep with their mother, they get so much close to
bond.
Each other. They bond, they talk a lot, they share. Even me, when I was growing up, I would enjoy my mother's. I had both parents, but as long as my dad was not there, or in the morning when we would wake up, the first thing, even before you think of going to school, you first run to your parents' bed, and then you first play in that bed and disorganize it.
Actually, that's Dixon. That's a very nice observation. When you are not around home, the parents, or rather the children, go to your bedroom and their mother.
To protect the mother. That means that now
it points to a lot. It speaks volumes to how actually fathers need to conduct in the homes.
Yeah, and that's the thing. And for me, when I'm there, it's only my daughter who wants to come and sleep with me, which
it's,
I think
it's a
okay.
Vote of no confidence in the father.
In the father, for the boys, they say, "Daddy, first we're going to bed," because they feel I'm the security. I can do anything.
Yes.
I can protect the family.
Yeah.
But when I'm there, if the boys feel, because I have two boys and one girl, so the first are boys.
Yes.
And these are 10 and 10 and 9 years old. but they think that they are providing security to their mother, so their mother needs to be protected.
Yes.
And both and all of them feel comfortable with that. The mother also welcomes them, and so. So that means the way we are raised, someone who's raised by the single parent, and someone who's raised by both parents, there's a big distinction.
Yes.
Because each parent has a way of grooming this child, especially when it comes to discipline. The way the father is disciplining the boy and the girl is different from a child who has one parent.
We are in a generation in a century where we are talking about children's rights.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, there's a very huge very big conversation about whether children's rights are justified in our societies or not. What do you think about those rights? And certainly because you'll see you're not supposed to beat them, you're not supposed to, and yet this was like a punishing tool for the parents. And we all went through this whole kind of parenting where we were beaten, and this is no longer a practice. Mm. It is called human rights violations or even child rights violations. Mm. What do you think about those kind of rights? Are they not taking us in a very wrong direction of society?
They're not taking us in the wrong direction, but the way we are implementing them on the children, and the way even the children exercising them. Actually, most children, they want their rights and entitlement, but without responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
So for them, they have rights.
No, but Dixon, how do you ensure responsibilities in children, for example, for example, them to know their rights? And because their right means a blanket check.
Yeah, but they need to know. For example, let me give an example. Like a child knows or should not, I am supposed to be going to school. It's my right to go to school. So
but it's also my responsibility.
Yeah, it's the child is not supposed to study and be in school. So for me, I would do my part to make sure that your right is fulfilled as a child. I pay school fees, I take it to school. But I would not force you to read. Like the way you said, you can take a cow to the well.
Yes,
but you
can't force it to drink.
So likewise, our children. Or if I know that I'm supposed to be providing food for you, I will bring food, I make sure that it's well prepared and it's on the table. But I may not really force you to eat the food. Because it's your choice to eat the food.
But this kind of rights sometimes challenge our cultures, our faith, in how actually we're supposed to raise up children.
Yeah, the challenge is that we are now copying a lot from the Western. Because like in the Western, a child can do anything. A child can cry. And before you know it, a child can even call the police and say, my mother was, or maybe they just spank me, anything can attract police's attention, which is not the case here. So much as we haven't gone that extent, but even then, I feel that our children, they know their rights, but they don't know their responsibility.
Mm.
For example, I have a cousin, the father was not paying school fees. The child went to police and reported the case. And they called the parent and said, you must pay fees for this child.
Mm.
And the parent paid. And now the man finished the university. So you can say now, because the child knew his right, he was able to go and report and request for his entitlement. But he knew that my responsibility also as someone who reported is to be in class and study. Right now, like I always tell my children, I tell them their rights, I tell them they should not be bullied, I tell them how to be assertive, I've taught them how to be assertive, how to be confident. If someone, maybe for example, abuses them and say you're short, you're like this, I always tell them what to tell them.
Yes.
So that they are not affected.
They can fight for their rights and for their space.
But I tell them that as they are doing it, as they're trying to defend themselves, they should not abuse it. Don't again be the one to abuse. For example, if someone says that you are ugly, tell them it's okay to be ugly. After all, that one I know, but it's okay. We may have no problem with it, so that you can shut the other person down. Or one of my boys is short, and I'm told he was told that his fellow kids always bully him at your short. I just told him, you know what? When they tell you you're short. For me, it's intelligent. I just tell them, okay, I'm short, but here, I'm kawa.
Mm.
And he enjoys that. So he told me, you know what, daddy and mommy, they tell me those things that they no longer make sense to me because I tell them, it's okay to be short.
Yeah, but as long as I am.
Yeah, as long as I'm able to speak, as long as I'm able to perform in class better than you. So now when a child Tis the other one who has
a. They get a clear defense.
Yeah, clear defense, which was not now different from me when I was growing up.
Yes.
Because I was also good.
You were not empowered with those kind of defensive mechanisms.
Instead, they would put me down, but because I had that inner strength, the inner beauty.
Which may not be in other children.
Yes,
by
in other
the way.
Children. Actually, most children don't have that. So they lose a lot. They can't really know how to handle this kind of abuse.
Rights come with, of course, a lot of new things, new technologies, new gadgets. New social media platforms, communication channels, but also actually get exposed to cyber harassment, but also to content that do not deserve to be taken to children. How best can parents safeguard their children from harmful online content? Let's get to that.
Now, actually, I want to request parents to always pay attention to what their children are doing with these gadgets. Because, you know, we get these gadgets and give them to our children, and we don't think about the consequences. And then you buy data even for your child, and you don't even bother to know what the child is going to use that data for. The child goes on a phone, maybe even it could be for a genuine reason. But now they keep clicking things.
Yes.
These pop-ups which keep coming.
And you see with the tech gadgets usually keep popping in different, different suggestions content, and all that.
Yeah. And the kids want to follow and know what is happening. Then before they know it, they see attractive pictures. Then you want to know what is this picture about. Then you keep throwing, and you know these things have hidden agenda. A picture and, which looks like good outside, as they keep clicking, it takes them to even us as adults.
Yes, it takes you to porn and all that.
And we face these challenges in our offices on our own gadgets here at
home.
You follow a certain link thinking that you're going to get what you want.
And then you find
Or you are reading the content of what you want, etc. But there's that advert. And then advert, if you're not careful, you click on it accidentally and takes it to porn. Now, for you, you're adult enough to say, this is not for me. For me, I was on this. You can't, maybe you may guard yourself against destruction, but the child may not know that. So you continue watching and moving. So what I'm telling parents these days, before you give your child that gadget, or you buy data, what is the purpose of that gadget? And if you have, you maybe know the child is somehow using that gadget for a rightful purpose, how often do you check to know what this child is doing apart from that purpose? Because, for example, since COVID, we are now most people are now doing things by Zoom. And of course, even our children sometimes learn on Zoom, but also other engagements on Zoom. So a child could be maybe on Zoom, and the Zoom, like even our children also, they have a lot of fellowships.
Yes.
They do online on Zoom. And there's that of now virtual space. They are now, we are all actually now in the virtual world. But knowing that a child is using this gadget at this particular moment for this purpose is okay.
Are you supposed to be present when these children actually are using?
We are so much protective and present, especially during COVID. Before they went
because you also had time. Anyway, that time.
It's not that I had time. Actually, I realized that we are losing time on other things because we are always protective and wanted to know that they are using the gadgets very well. What, so we taught them how to use it. And that time they were still 8 years, 7 years, and around five. So we taught them how to use these gadgets. And we told them, if you're on Zoom, for example, because sometimes you want to be at home, they have the gadget there, but they don't know how to use it. And it's time and they have to be there. For example, like our children, they have a band, and they always sing. Lead praise and worship on Zoom. So it was always like bothering us. You're not at home, then you're on tension. So we taught them how to use Zoom, what to do, how to switch on the MiFi, how to know. So all these things they know. How, if they're using a phone and they're using a laptop, how do they hotspot for internet? They know all these things. Even at that age,
they can have access.
They can have access.
But what is your role in ensuring that
in
this access
make sure
is
this access not abused? For example, they know that this is my laptop. I have given it for them to use it for this particular purpose. But afterwards, they should keep
You have to categorically state the purpose.
Set clear, boundaries.
Yes, boundaries of operation and how actually they have to use it.
Check the content. If, for example, they're using it for other things, even our
after using the content, you have to check what they have been actually doing.
Yeah, but sometimes you know, they can have these gadgets for like every day. They have full access, not specifically for that particular purpose. But then, for example, you give them a smartphone. Maybe.
But at what age should you be actually allowed to give, or should children be left to access these gadgets?
That also depends on what they're using it for. Because for
depending, regardless of what they are going to use it for. But is it really necessary to have
it's
young kids to...
For example, if now your child is maybe even high school, what is the smartphone for? I have seen parents who say, for me, before my child goes to campus, there is no need for a smartphone. What is it for?
But is it necessary, honestly?
It's not necessary. But at this, but for some,
but in this generation, it is, Dixon.
Because
like these days, like for example, high school, you know, children. Some schools are now using computers. They're no longer using exercise books.
Remember when we were speaking, we said it depends
on the environment where we
then
were.
You said, but at what age? What age exactly? I said that you should really see that by the time you give this child, it is a really need.
But for your children, they are still 8, 7 and all that, and 6.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
you are able to give them
because
gadgets.
Because it's a need. Now another thing that now, for example, our children now, for example, the boys, we always send them out for different things, for training, especially during holidays.
Yes.
So because we wanted to keep in touch with them for communication, uh-huh, because sometimes we send a boy that pick them. We don't go and pick them ourselves. So we gave them a small phone, what we call a touch, like a small, the one
the
with
buttons. Yes.
So that when we want to communicate to them,
you can easily access them.
You can, yeah. Or when they have something they want to tell us, they can easily. So, like for example, now because we want our children to be more compliant. At 5 years, even at 3 years, actually.
Three years.
Because some parents use this.
Dixon, school. 3 years, yeah. A child of 3 years.
Like some of them are given now a screen at home. Don't you have a TV at home? Who is watching it? And what time do they start watching it? So at 3 years, now these things are happening in our family, especially for screens. But even some parents, they use these gadgets for games. Then the worst part of it is when they are using these gadgets for distraction. I am very busy. I don't want my child to disturb me. Let me just give him this laptop.
Yes.
To be on the game.
Or the phone.
Or let me just put him on. Let me just switch on the TV that he can be watching. Then the whole day, the child is on the TV because you don't want to be disrupted. Now that's where the dilemma is. So depending on the purpose of that gadget again, what is the purpose? Why are you giving this child this gadget at that particular moment? But this is just for communication. Just because now there's too much pressure. Your child tells me, mommy must buy me this phone, even a better phone than what you possess. And then you go and get a loan because you don't have money, but you want to please your child. And, you know, my daughter, my boy, I will be spending, you go and borrow money, even, you know, even get all your money from your saving. And then you buy this gadget, even better than what you have. Because for them, they know good phones now. You know what is good and what is not good. Or something they just see from their friends, and I want that phone like my friend. Even if they don't see it, but it's that particular phone.
After accessing this kind of content, especially on these tech gadgets, children get influenced in very different aspects of life. How should parents, and how can parents really guide them to not to be influenced by this kind of content that they receive? Because let me give you an example. If a child is seeing somebody's pranking a parent, she or he may think that this is
it's
normal.
It's the way to go.
And then you're going to prank your father. Before you know, you have a slap. How best can children, or parents, protect their children from this kind of influences? And some influences are not really good.
Not really good, yeah.
Yeah, you have practices of, for example, you know, the same sex, you know, relationships and all that. They are all coming through that kind of content. But anyway, we'll have actual responses after this very short break. We are discussing parenting in the 21st century with me in the studio is Dixon Tumuriame. Is a parenting coach. And of course, we're going to take a short break. When we return, we want to start from that exact same point.
Better yields and increase their incomes.